Good morning, everyone. On behalf of our director, Dr. G. Narahari Shastri, and the CSIR NIST family, it gives me immense pleasure to extend a very warm welcome to our today's eminent scientist speaker of the CSIR Summer Research Training Program, Professor Govinda Swami Mungesh, who is one of the most prominent scientists of this country in the current time, who is professor in the Department of Inorganic and Physical Chemistry, Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru. Thank you very much, sir, for accepting our invitation to deliver the talk in this forum. And a warm welcome to everyone who are joining for this talk. Honorable Alok Dhawan, sir, good morning and warm welcome. Sir, this online summer research training program is first of this kind during this pandemic situation of COVID. Every year, although there have been research training program, but this year almost all research internship programs are stopped and students and faculties are, you know, stuck at home. So with the initiative and conception of our director, Dr. G. Narahari Shastri sir, under his leadership, this online program was started about more than 2 months back, and we could able to coordinate this program for all CSIR labs and providing training to several thousand of students and faculties across India. So it's a pan-India program. And in this process, Honorable Dr. Alok Dhawan sir, Director of CSIR Indian Institute of Toxicological Research, Lucknow, and Dr. V. Mutka V. Head, CSIR 4PI, Bangalore, have been associated from the very beginning, and their support is tremendous. So this program consists of eminent scientist talks where several eminent scientists, several eminent personalities have been delivering talks, and also, you know, Royal Society of Chemistry and DVT India Alliance is also part of talk, and already personalities from Royal Society, they have been delivering several talks during this period. And in addition to this eminent scientist talk, there are lectures on particular research field on various, projects, then demonstration of equipment, sophisticated equipments, which are available with us, and as well as the demonstration of different experimental techniques are being carried out for the benefit of the students and faculties of which are stuck at home in this pandemic situation. So even in addition to this, there are surveys and questionnaires also related to various problems in this online training program. So sir, these lectures are live in YouTube as well as Facebook of our SRTP in addition to this MS Team platform. So with this now, I would like to request our Honorable Director, Dr. G. N. Shastri sir, to introduce Professor Mungesh to the audience. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lucky. Professor Alok Dhawan, would you like to say a few words before I can?
I think we are really looking forward to Dr. Mungesh's talk. I think students should be eagerly awaiting. This has been a fantastic program the past 2 months. We've had very senior people from the country, all the secretaries have spoken, and they've sort of also shared why these kind of research internships are important. And with the current national education policy, I think it even gives more strength to the research program starting from the undergraduate level. So I think we have tried to pull out the role models from the country and put them on this program so that students can see that at the end of the day, scientists are common people, common human beings from this country, and you know, they do wonderful science which is globally recognized. And that's how this program has evolved. We were very skeptical to begin with, but within the week that Shastri put it up on his website, we got about 16,000 applications for students to do this kind of summer research internship or research program. So I think the other advantage which otherwise these students will not get was the fact that each of these students is able to listen to talks from a variety of people from different disciplines. So I think that is a major advantage. Otherwise, they will go into a particular lab for 2 months and they will be, or 6 months, whatever it is, but they'll be confined to that lab. On a digital platform, I think this is a very unique experiment, if I may use that word, where students are exposed to a lot of different facets of science that is being done in this country. Not only science, how it is being converted into technology and how it's taken forward. So I think it's a fantastic thing that Dr. Shastri was able to start off. We are very fortunate that we have Dr. Mukesh today with us, and he's also a very distinguished scientist of this country. So I welcome Dr. Mukesh on behalf of CSIR to you to this program, and I'm sure the students will be very excited listening to your talk. So Shastri, over to you for the formal introduction.
Thank you very much, Alok. Professor Govindaswamy Mukesh is one of the finest researchers in the area of chemical synthesis and chemical biology that country has in this age group. When we are talking about the role models, I am very, very happy that Mukesh is really one of the role models for most people to aim at. He is not only a fantastic researcher, and he goes out of the way to provide the leadership in trying to conduct the science, whether he is in several committees of decision making or in the editorial boards or running the Chemical Research Society as a secretary as well as a vice president. The value addition that he provides in everything that we have is of great value, and more importantly, he is a person who is very passionate about spreading research and spreading excellence. And you name awards that are there, which are very important, and he is a recipient of the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, the Infosys Prize, the J.C. Bose Fellowship, AstraZeneca Fellowship, Royal Society, West India Young Scientist Award, CDRI Award of Excellence, Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, Ramanna Fellowship, Rajiv Goel Prize, Bhagyaratna Award, CRSI Silver Medal, Asim Mahrotra Commemorative Lecture Gold Medal, and he's also fellow of all the three Academy of Sciences, and he's the president of Asian Chemical Editorial Society and the vice president of CRSI, and he's the convener of one of the very important program, Kishore Vaigyanik Protsahan Yojana. Besides, he's on the editorial boards of several important journals like Chemistry, a European Journal, Camp of Society, Biological Chemistry, OBC, ACS Omega, Bioorganic Chemistry, and so on and so forth. And it's a great pleasure for me to have Professor Mukesh, who have accepted to come and then give this talk. And I don't want to complete his biodata because we are looking for his talk. And if I wanted to really go through entire biodata, he will not have much time to give a talk. With these things, Professor Mukesh.
Good morning to all of you. And thank you, Dr. Dhawan and Dr. Shastri, for the kind introduction. So I'm happy to be part of this program giving talk here. I understand that students from various disciplines attend this talk. And in today's talk, I will be talking to you on chemical biology of artificial enzymes. I'm not going to talk more technical details. I'm going to give an overview because given the fact that the audience is coming from different disciplines, in the end, I will try to convince you that why working in such interface area is. So last year has been celebrated as the International Year of the Periodic Table. So what I would like to start with for the young students, I'll give you a brief overview of. I'll just put the slide. Are you able to see the slides?
Not yet, sir.
share. Okay.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, so today's talk, I'll start with the periodic table, and I'm sure many of you use periodic table regularly, and this is this International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry published this as part of IYPT, that is International Year of Periodic Table, in 2019. So when we talk about the elements of periodic table, so I will restrict myself to the elements of life and what are the elements which play major role in the life processes. I'll start with a few elements. Some of those elements you are aware of them. The elements present in human body. So I would like to compare the elements present in Earth's crust and in human. If you look at this slide, oxygen constitute about 46.4% of Earth's crust. Next one is silicon, which is not present in biological system. And if you look at in human systems, oxygen constitutes about 61% of the total number of atoms. Then carbon, hydrogen. So many of these elements, carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur, they comprise more than 98% of the human body. For example, carbohydrate, nucleic acids, proteins, hormones, and vitamins, and so on. But if you look at the metals in seawater and in human plasma, if you take iron, we all know that iron is important for a human. It's 0.005% as compared to human plasma, it is 20 to 30. So a difference between this is about 400,000. It's a huge difference how these metal ions are used in human body. For example, zinc, copper, molybdenum, cobalt, all these play important role. So looking at the periodic table and coming to what are the elements which are important? When we talk about metal ions, some of them are toxic, some of them are toxic at higher concentrations, and some of them are toxic to human. So I would say all things can be poisons. It depends on dosage, individual health, and the way of administration. So we need to keep this in mind. For example, we know human diseases related to metal ions, right? For example, osteoporosis is due to deficiency in the calcium level. Anemia, deficiency in iron, cobalt, copper, or excess of molybdenum. Lung diseases, psychotic disorders, heart failures, and convulsions, and so on. So when we come to the periodic table again, how many of these elements play important role in the human body? So I have classified this into three categories. You can see the one which are highlighted in green, which we know as bulk biological elements. So they are present in very large quantities. If you take, for example, calcium, which is present in kilograms in human body, right? So they are part of the bones. Hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, these are all bulk elements. Phosphorus is a backbone of the gene, nucleic acids, DNA, RNA. But when you come to essential elements, the one which are highlighted in red color, most of them are first row transition metals, vanadium, chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, copper, zinc, and one of the second row, which is molybdenum, and in main group selenium, iodine, fluorine, and also there are some elements possibly essential, for example tungsten, arsenic, bromine. So considering this, we can say that 28 elements which we consider the elements of life, and all the biomolecules, the biological processes, they use one of these or one or more of these 28 elements. So what I will do in chemical biology, I'm going to talk about very brief about very fundamental, which many students will be able to understand, and later part of my talk I'm going to mix little bit about the recent research in this area to give a glimpse of what is going on today in the area of chemical biology. And this is an interfacial area. So this is at the interface of chemistry and biology. So when we study science in the schools, we study, for example, science. And when we come to higher classes, we study physics, we study chemistry, maths, we study biology. And then you come in chemistry, for example, a specialization. You take chemistry as the specialization. We study physical chemistry, inorganic chemistry, organic chemistry, and so on. But when you come to research, we can choose two paths. One is working on very specialized areas, trying to understand the fundamental, trying to understand the molecular level processes. And once we understand that, then we expand that. And we become more broader, and you work in different disciplines to understand an important problem. So chemical biology is one of such areas where you take the ideas from chemistry as well as biology, using chemistry to address some of the biological problems. And this is the term which is still not very well defined. Some people say that studying chemistry of biological system, if you ask me what is the difference between biochemistry and chemical biology, and many think that they are all same, but in my opinion, it's not same. If we study the chemistry of biological systems, try to understand the chemistry, we call it as biochemistry or biological chemistry. But if you use chemistry or chemicals to regulate biological systems, and that is actually true chemical biology. So we can use small molecules, we can use peptides, we can use proteins to regulate biological systems. We can do it at the cellular level, we can do it at the organ levels, or we can do it at the whole body systems. So you all studied central dogma of molecular biology. We know that genes are important, and DNA is present in the nucleus. From that, RNA is produced. RNA copies the message from the DNA, which is called the transcription, binding to the DNA and taking the message and producing proteins in response to the requirement of the cells, which we call it translation. The protein synthesis happens on ribosomes. When we consider chemical approaches, it can be related to the gene, DNA, RNA, are proteins, some of them are enzymes, or small molecules. So the chemists are interested in dealing with three of these aspects and try to understand the chemistry of this system first, and then design small molecules, proteins, or synthetic genetic materials to regulate the biological systems. I will begin with a very well-known fact. You know, we all know about the different colors of blood. It can be red. In human, it is red. Can be blue. Blood can be green, and blood can be violet. But if you look at the chemistry, what is responsible for such change in the color? And we know the red color of blood due to the presence of hemoglobin. And hemoglobin is a heme protein where the oxygen binds. You can see the structure of the heme. Don't worry about the details of how they function and so on. You look at the ligand systems, how it's changed going from hemoglobin to hemerythrin. So if you, the red color in blood is due to hemoglobin, and the blue color, for example, some of the species like spiders, mollusks, octopuses, squids, they all use a protein called hemocyanin instead of hemoglobin for oxygen transport. We know oxygen transport is a fundamental process, right? And no one can survive without oxygen transport. But if you look at the molecular level, how the oxygen binds to hemoglobin, to the metal center in hemoglobin, hemocyanin. If you go to certain worms, they have a chlorine, and that is responsible for the green color in this species. And marine worms, peanut worms, for example. So they have hemerythrin instead of hemoglobin, and that's why the blood is violet in color. And just changing the metal environment, all of them except hemocyanin have iron in the active site, and hemocyanin has a copper in the active site. And why we need to understand the chemistry of such systems? By understanding this chemistry, for example, we understand how blood works at the molecular level. And this is a part of the protein structure, which is myoglobin. One of the earliest example of X-ray structures, the first protein structure studied by X-ray was myoglobin. And Kentview and others won Nobel Prize for solving the structure of myoglobin, and a very, very important protein. And this binds oxygen in a reversible way. And when we look at the oxygen binding to metal and the protein in human body, is amazing. And how hemoglobin, myoglobin reversibly bind oxygen to the iron side. And its specific arrangements of amino acids. And why hydrogen bonding is important. Why the metal coordination, ligand coordination to metal is important. Why amino acid like histidine is important. And myoglobin gives an answer to all these questions. And very, very fundamental proteins and involved in oxygen transport and storage. Why do we need such proteins? Because oxygen is much more soluble in non-polar solvent than polar solvents, and the human body consists of water, which is a polar solvent. So simple diffusion will not deliver dioxygen fast enough to internal cells. And that's the reason why we require oxygen carrier. That's also true for other animals like mollusks. You can see the horseshoe crab, you can see the blood, you can see this color of this is a blue. And this is due to the presence of a hemocyanin. You can look at the active site of hemocyanin. It has a two copper site, and oxygen binds between the two copper sites and become oxygen hemocyanin. Then it reversibly releases oxygen to produce hemocyanin. And another amazing protein. And this species They contain humocyanin at the concentrations of about 50 gram per liter, very high concentrations. You can see all of these species shown on the right hand side. Octopus, scorpion, snail, all of them have humocyanin as metal oxygen transport systems. And 2009, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine was given to three people for the discoveries of how cells sense and adapt to oxygen availability, and the amazing studies how the concentration of oxygen, the availability of oxygen, how the cells sense them and how they adapt them. If you go from normoxia is the conditions where we have a normal oxygen pressure, and decrease in the oxygen pressure used to anoxia or hypoxia. Hypoxia is a deficiency in the oxygen level, or you know, then it goes to anoxia, the cells die. So hypoxia is conditions where the oxygen concentration is low. How do they sense this? And how do they maintain the biological processes in response to the level of oxygen? It's amazing. So today I'm going to talk about enzymes and artificial enzymes. I'm not going to cover the whole literature. I'm going to give a few examples why working in such area is important, because research can be done in any areas. If you find a new ideas, you can explore them. But over a period of time, we realize that whether is it worth pursuing? Is it worth pursuing the research that we are doing? And why do we do such research? And what is that we are going to get, and what, how this is going to benefit the society? It can be a different discipline, chemistry, biology, maths, any other discipline, engineering, but how is it going to benefit the society? We know enzymes. I'm sure many of you heard about enzymes, and enzymes are biological molecules, right? Typically proteins that speed up chemical reactions that support life. And that's the reason we call them biological catalysts. They play essential roles in respiration, number of proteins involved in respiration, digestion of food, muscle and nerve function, many other functions. They bind to molecules and alter them in very specific way. And in chemistry, we know, you know, a substrate is converted to product, a reagent is converted to product. And these are chemical transformations. And the biological transformations are catalyzed by enzymes. And the human body contains hundreds of such enzymes. Example, amylase, and very, very fundamental enzymes that converts starch into sugars. And this enzyme present in the saliva that begins the chemical process of digestion. So glucose is the most important source of energy in all organisms. And how glucose is made is all done by enzymes. Enzymes in neuronal systems and in brain, enzymes functions are important. For example, acetylcholine esterase. When acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter, and that once one molecule of acetylcholine is produced, it has to be hydrolyzed by acetylcholine esterase to produce acetate and choline. Otherwise, what happens is that the nerve failure happens, it leads to paralysis and death. And that's the reason why the effect of acetylcholine esterase enzyme is important in the brain. And some of the practical examples are, for example, we use the pesticides, right, in agriculture field, pesticides, insects, and many of these pesticides are inhibitors of acetylcholine esterase. So why pesticides affect the brain functions? Nerve agents, for example, nerve agents used during World War, sarin, tabin, and many phosphorus containing nerve agents, they irreversibly block acetylcholinesterase, and therefore it leads to nerve failure. Mosquito repellents, we normally use at home mosquito repellents, you know, you use vaporize that and then mosquito they go away. And these are all based on inhibition of acetylcholinesterases. So some of the practical applications of recovering acetylcholinesterase activity, you know, antidotes are used. How antidotes functions when somebody is toxified with the pesticides. Enzymes which are involved in polymerization, DNA polymerase, for example, they are involved in the gene regulations, gene synthesis. All these are enzymes. What are, for example, why do we cut? Why do cut apples turn brown? Have you ever asked such questions? And people talk about the kitchen chemistry, right? A lot of chemistry happens in the kitchen. And you cut apple, leave it for some time, and they turn brown. All these are enzymatic reactions, and these have a catechol oxidase enzymes, which oxidizes catechols to benzopyrene by using molecular oxygen. And these are copper enzymes. I talked about hemocyanin, which is a copper protein in oxygen transport. If these enzymes use oxygen to perform a chemical reactions, what is required? Molecular oxygen, but how these enzymes further process molecules, and that's important. And the benzopyrene is brown in color, and that's the reason why this apple cut apples turn brown. Very interesting reactions. And you might have noticed, you know, you add a little bit of lemon juice to apple juice. Apple juice, you make apple juice and keep it for a few minutes, it turns brown. But if you go to a shop and ask for an apple juice, they add a little bit of milk. So what is happening there? If you add a few drops of milk, why the apple juice doesn't turn brown? If you add a little bit of lemon, add a few drops of lemon on apple pieces, you can preserve. What's happening? Lemon has citric acid and milk has lactoferrin, which are excellent metal chelators. So they bind to the metal ion, blocking the oxidation reactions. And these are the enzymes. And we'll come to what is artificial enzymes. The idea is not new. It was started, the idea was given by Breslau in 1980s. And we know about enzymatic reactions, where the substrate comes and binds to the active site of an enzyme. Then enzyme substrate complex is formed and the products are eliminated. And what we consider as active site, that is where the reaction actually takes place. So one can design simple catalyst to achieve some desirable features of enzymes. They are, in a simple terms, they are called artificial enzymes. It can be small molecules, it can be peptides, can be proteins. All of them can be termed as artificial enzymes if they have certain features of enzymes and or if they perform their enzymatic reactions in biological systems. For example, the synthetic biology, lot of activities going on recently, and the people make catalyst from synthetic genetic polymers. It's challenging to design artificial enzymes to perform very specific reactions inside living cells. So my group focus on design of artificial enzymes to regulate metabolic, cardiovascular, and neurological processes under disease conditions. You all know about hydrogen peroxide, right? And I'm sure you all handled hydrogen peroxide at some time, some point of time. and hydrogen peroxide and the central redox theory for aerobic life. I talked about normoxia and hypoxia conditions where the oxygen level is altered and how do they sense, how the cells sense oxygen level, 2019 Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine. Hydrogen peroxide was first synthesized by Alexander von Humboldt. This was the first synthetic peroxide, which is known as a base. He produced in 1799 as a byproduct of his attempts to decompose air. In 18, he first described that the treatment of barium peroxide with nitric oxide produces a compound which he described as oxygenated water, and now that is termed as hydrogen peroxide. But the first indication that hydrogen peroxide was formed in bio was proposed by Loewe almost 120 years ago in tobacco leaves, a new enzyme of general occurrence in organism. A seminal paper published in Science in 1900, and that paved way for identification of many of the pathways related to hydrogen peroxide. However, the role of hydrogen peroxide in cellular respiration was a matter of intense debate. You know, science developed by arguments, debates, right? If somebody says something and everybody accepts it, it's fine if it is correct theory, but also it can lead to a lot of debates, a lot of arguments. And that's how science develops. So the hydrogen peroxide role was proposed by a Nobel laureate, Wieland, in 1913. And he suggested that hydrogen peroxide may be produced during respiration. But another Nobel laureate, Warburg, said that because there is no experiment that supports the theory and no consequence that fits the theory, it should no longer be accepted. And intense argument between these two people. And finally, Wieland frustrated and he sacrificed a dog, but did not find hydrogen peroxide. It's interesting. And today we know why he did not find hydrogen peroxide, because a number of proteins, enzymes in the human body worked on hydrogen peroxide. And it plays an important role. There is no doubt about that. And there are thousands of publications on the role of hydrogen peroxide in biological systems. And for the students, I would like to bring a very, very fundamental reaction in human body. And I summarize that, hundreds of reactions or thousands of reactions in human body in one equations here. When we talk about molecular oxygen, we breathe during respiration, it's used. You just think about adding one electron to molecular oxygen. You get superoxide, right? That's what one electron is, superoxide, which is done by enzymatically in human body, NADPH oxidase, xanthine oxidase. So these are the enzymes that add one electron to molecular oxygen to make it superoxide. You add one more electron, you get hydrogen peroxide. One more electron, hydroxyl radicals, and one more electron, water. So if you look at the conversion of oxygen to water, that's what happened during respiration. Four electrons are added. And that happens in mitochondria, right? Four electrons are added to molecular oxygen to get water. But in this process, you can see superoxide is generated, hydrogen peroxide is generated, hydroxyl radical is generated. And while superoxide and hydrogen peroxides are important for various biological functions, hydroxyl radical is toxic to the cells and it damages DNA proteins. So therefore, there must be enzymes in human body to take care of this. And these are called the reactive oxygen species or partially reduced oxygen species, and an imbalance between the reactive oxygen species generating system and a scavenging system can lead to oxidative stress, and a term which is commonly used to describe the imbalance between these two systems. Superoxide dismutase act on superoxide, convert that to hydrogen peroxide in human body. Glutathione peroxidase, catalase, they act on hydrogen peroxide to control the hydrogen peroxide level. And I have shown here the hydrogen peroxide bottle and the fingers here. So what happens in the lab, if you try to open the hydrogen peroxide bottles with the bare hands, you must wear gloves when you are working in chemistry lab. But for some reason, if you don't use, you see white color on the skin. What is happening here is that the skin proteins get oxidized by hydrogen peroxide. So you see white color. If the proteins are so reactive to hydrogen peroxide, how hydrogen peroxide is produced in the human body and how it is maintained? That is where the redox control, for example, hydrogen peroxide production, protection and signaling action. And hydrogen peroxide is a necessary evil for cell signaling. You look at this figure. If you take iron, for example, iron, water, and oxygen, right? Rusting, right? You put an iron rod outside, wait for a few days, what happens? It's rusting. But human body has about 4 to 5 grams of iron. Only 1 milligram is lost per day. And human body has water and human body has oxygen. Why no rusting takes place? Rusting do takes place in human body. You know, rusting means generation of reactive oxygen species by reaction of iron with water and oxygen. And that's what I talked about in the previous slide. What if incomplete reduction of molecular oxygen releases superoxide and hydrogen peroxide, which the natural system cannot control? It leads to diseases. We talk about neurodegenerative diseases, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, and we talked about cardiovascular diseases, diabetes. When the metal ions are dysregulated in the human body, and that's the reason ion in biology is tightly regulated. To understand this term, ion in biology is tightly regulated, I need about 4 to 5 hours to explain. What does that mean? How it is tightly regulated and what are the consequences? If iron is released freely in human body, other metals, redox active metals like copper, manganese, cobalt, these are released in free form. What happens to the human body? And how the human body controls this? They use enzymes. If you see here, the amount of superoxide is controlled by SOD, that is superoxide dismutase. Amount of hydrogen peroxide is controlled by peroxyredoxins, glutathione peroxidase, catalase. So if you look at the right side, which is the redox biology that leads to signaling, hydrogen peroxide plays an important role. If it oxidizes a protein thiolate, which is a sulfur, it forms a sulfenic acid, which we considered as a redox biology. But if it reacts with a free metal ion, it changes hydroxyl radical that leads to DNA damage and lipid oxidation, and which is oxidative stress. And how the body fine balance this redox biology and oxidative stress, that is amazing. And that's the reason why one need to do research in this area. When you talk about oxidative stress, you name any disease that you are aware. Stroke, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, Caisson disease, hypertension, asthma, hyperoxia, rheumatoid arthritis, aging, cancer, diabetes, atherosclerosis, retinal damage, all these diseases are associated with oxidative stress and how oxygen is metabolized in the human body. It's just simple, right? Two atomic atoms, two atoms, molecular oxygen. But you look at the way they play a role in biological systems. And this is due to an imbalance between oxidative stress and the scavenging of reactive oxygen species. And that's where we work on the cellular redox regulation by glutathione peroxidase, an enzyme which controls hydrogen peroxide level. And we make small molecules like Epsilon, which is undergoing several clinical trials, reported in 1984 as glutathione peroxidase mimetic by two groups in Europe, and which is undergoing several clinical trials today. And the human trial suggests that rescue drug could be safer treatment for bipolar disorder. Or a drug destined for a scrap heap has been rescued by Oxford scientists who may have found a new role. And more such roles are emerging. So our group is working on small molecules. I talked about artificial enzymes. Artificial enzymes can be small molecules, peptides, or proteins, as long as they function as an enzymes in biological systems. They can be called as artificial enzymes. Here we showed that this particular compound can function as an enzyme in human cells. And the glutathione peroxidase is an antioxidant enzyme, which is important for biological systems to function. And these compounds can substitute or can mimic the function of these enzymes in human cells. And they have great potential in developing them as a drug for the treatment of diseases associated with this. We also worked on nanomaterials which function as glutathione peroxidase, superoxide dismutase. This is a nanozyme which is derived from vanadium pentoxide. What we have shown, the bulk P2O5 is toxic. We know, chemists know that vanadium is oxidizing agents in plus 5 oxidation state, right? P2O5 is used as an oxidizing agent. But we have shown that if the bulk material become a nanoform, the antioxidant property can be observed in the cells, and oxidant become antioxidant when making it in a nanoform. It has a defensive effect, antioxidant defense, in biological systems. We also looked at the effect of crystal facets. You know, the surface is responsible for the activities. Can we bring a specific enzymatic activity on nanomaterials? Changing the synthetic methodology, fine-tuning the synthesis, making nanomaterials with a specific plane. Can we make a isozymes? Because we know isozymes are isoforms of enzymes, which have a similar activity, but they can fine-tune the chemical reaction in membrane cells. And nanoisozymes. So we can fine-tune the surface of the nanomaterials to bring a specific activities. So I often tell my students that, you know, making molecules is not very difficult, but making molecules with a specific purpose, with the desired property, is what is challenging. And as a chemist, synthetic chemist, and it's challenging to design and bring a specific property into the molecules. And MN3PO4 nanoscience, we have shown that multi-enzyme activity, it can mimic a catalase, superoxide dismutase, and glutathione peroxidase. So next few minutes, I am going to talk about two more enzyme systems. We all know about the role of selenium and iodine in human body. Right, I have put a very, very fundamental, and you know, you start reading about this maybe from fourth grade or fifth grade. I have actually taken this, you know, from a school textbook. We know tadpole, the cycle, the frog cycle, tadpole cycle, eggs become embryo, then tadpoles, and then there is a process that takes place which is called metamorphosis. And metamorphosis is the stage where tadpole turns into adult frogs, right? And then, you know, this cycle continues. And there is only one compound in the system which is responsible for the metamorphosis is known as thyroxine. And you know about thyroxine, which is a thyroid hormone in human body. And two elements which are responsible, selenium and iodine. How many of you know that if you grow tadpole in a water which does not have iodine, the tadpole will remain tadpole, will never turn into frog. Amazing, right? And iodine is important for the metamorphosis in the form of thyroxine. Here I have shown the chemical structure of thyroxine, and we know thyroxine is produced in the thyroid gland, which is thyroid gland is located in the neck region, and a butterfly shaped gland which produces thyroxine, you can see, which has a 4 iodine atoms, and this plays important role in various biological functions, which is produced in response to TSH produced in pituitary, and again that is controlled by hypothalamus, which is known as hypothalamus pituitary thyroid axis. And it doesn't produce right amount of thyroxine. It produces thyroxine, but the right amount of active thyroxine is controlled by an enzyme called iodothyronidiodinase. And this, don't worry about the complicated pathways of thyroxine synthesis. We all know we take iodized salt, we take iodine is important. Everybody says iodine is important, but many do not know why iodine is important. Iodide, which we take as part of the food, you can see here, which is in the bloodstream, enter the thyroid follicular cells, thyroid cells, by using a sodium iodide importers. It goes inside, and then the synthesis of thyroxine takes place in a very basic specialized cells in thyroid gland. And molecules are produced everywhere in the body, right? Various type of molecules are produced, but thyroxine is produced only in the thyroid gland. And a series of chemical reactions involving again enzymes like thyroid peroxidase, which oxidizes and couples iodothyronidiodinase to produce thyroxine, and endocytosis, proteolysis, cleaves thyroxine. Once thyroxine is made, it's taken outside the cells by a specific transporter called MCT8. Then it enters the blood circulation, go to different parts of the body. And this is the reason why if somebody undergoes a surgery, removal of thyroid gland, they must take synthetic thyroxine throughout the life, because there is no other cells in the body can produce thyroxine. Only the thyroid follicular cells in thyroid gland can produce thyroxines. These are enzymes which activate, inactivate thyroxines. So they are called iodothyronidiodinases. This is where the selenium is important, because these enzymes are selenoproteins. You know, selenocysteine is considered as the 21st amino acid. And these enzymes have the 21st amino acid in the active site. And very selectively remove iodine from one of outer ring or inner ring, you know, to produce either the active form T3 or the inactive form reverse T3. And that's the reason why understanding this is important. And this is from our group. We prepared the first functional mimic of iodothyronidiodinases by looking at the amino acid sequence of the iodothyronidiodinases. The U represents selenocysteine. You can see by introducing a thiol group next to the selenocysteine, we thought we may be able to achieve a functional mimic of these enzymes. It's not that simple. It took 10 years for us to get the first mimic of these enzymes. And we started sometime in 2001, and the first publication in this area came in 2010. And this is the model which functionally mimic. Before are exposed. What happened?
No, nothing. We can hear you. Go ahead.
Nothing. We can hear you.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. This is the compound which functionally mimics these enzymes. This I talked about artificial enzymes. These are small molecules, artificial enzymes that can function enzyme. And that is the challenging for the chemist to use just a few atoms to function an enzyme which has hundreds of. disorders. For example, in India, around 50 million people suffer from thyroid-related disorders. Of 60% are women. And why women are affected more by thyroid problems is something to do with the iodine and iron metabolisms, mainly iron metabolisms, because iron is a metal involved in synthesis of thyroxine, and women lose iron frequently as compared to men, and that's the reason women are affected more by thyroid-related problems. And there are various thyroid-related problems. The currently used drugs are antithyroid drugs or thyroid hormone treatment, both of which have serious side effects, and it's important to develop artificial enzymes, small molecules, that reversibly regulate thyroid hormones. So we also work on synthetic enzymes, synthetic proteins, by expanding the genetic code. Artificial enzymes can be made by expanding the genetic code. We can introduce synthetic amino acids into proteins with specific functions. And what our group has done, introduced halothyrosine instead of tyrosine, because when you use a halothyrosine, which is not a naturally occurring amino acids, so the natural synthetic machinery doesn't accept this as the substrate for making the proteins. So therefore, we need to modify the enzyme which accepts the amino acid, which is tRNA synthetase. We were able to introduce the halothyrosines, very, very specific reason for that. We wanted to transport protein into the cells without using any other systems like transfection agents or other things. So in this case, what we did, substituting one of the atoms in the protein, the hydrogen to iodine, we were able to transport green fluorescent protein inside the cells by using expanding the genetic code technology methodology. And by substituting one atoms, we get the protein inside the cells, and this use a halogen bonding interaction with the receptors, and then you can see that it transports inside the cells. So what I have explained so far to you is that how working at the interfaces, and it is facing the challenges, and the students working hard with dedication and trying to understand two disciplines, and certainly challenging. And what we have done, taking students from two disciplines and asking them to work together, they learn a lot. And chemistry students learn a lot of biology. Biology students learn a lot of chemistry, which I call it as, intra-lab collaboration. And I find it is efficient. One way of collaboration is that I make the molecule and give that to a biologist to study some of the properties. And if you look at the recent literature, many of the papers belong to this category. So the chemists make molecules, and we don't know what type of biological properties these molecules have. So we carry out different type of biological reactions, biological activities, then find that these molecules have certain activities. That is one way of looking at using the molecules. Other way is that looking at the bigger picture, what type of molecules we want to design. Look at the problems. Look at a disease for which there is no drug available. And I don't know, many of you know that there is no conceptually new drug from India so far. There are one or two drugs, many of them are generic variants, but conceptually new drugs require a lot of collaborative efforts. A collaboration between chemists, biologists, medicinal chemists, doctors, trying to understand the chemistry and biology of diseases, trying to make molecules which can be used to treat such diseases. So it's like top-down approach, looking at the bigger picture, what is required, and what is required what type of molecules that I should make in the laboratory. And this requires much more collaborative efforts, also understanding at the interfaces, understanding various disciplines, and that's where the students play major role in bringing together these disciplines and looking at the problem which is more important than looking at the discipline which is whether that is important or not. Once we chose the right problem, don't worry about the specializations, whether it's organic chemistry, inorganic or physical. Let's not worry about that. Look at the problems and a multidisciplinary approach to solve that problem. That's much more important. And in India, this is emerging now, this type of interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary work, collaborative efforts. The funding agencies are trying to encourage such efforts. And those who want to take such research activities, various funding schemes are available. And the SERB, DST started something called High Risk, High Reward project few days earlier, which is now renamed as SUPRA. And someone wants to take the bigger problems, challenging issues, not focusing only on research publications, but what is the outcome of such fundamental research. So in my opinion, fundamental research can be taken in two ways. One is going towards the right direction. For that, we know, we should know what is the right direction. We should know what is our target, what we want to achieve. Then moving little bit ahead, it doesn't have to be, one cannot take anything from the fundamental to the application, but moving in the right direction little bit, giving the chance for the next set of people to take it from there, or moving in the wrong direction without any aim, making molecules, making proteins, making peptides, taking it the wrong direction, where even if somebody wants to take it further, they will be moving further in the wrong direction. And that's the reason why we need to understand our target. And we may not be able to achieve target, we may not achieve target, but we can move the research towards little bit towards the right direction. And that's my approach, actually. And I hope I convinced you that, you know, working at such problem, important biological problems. And in this way, I may lose my identity. When we say that identity, you know, in science, we talk about, you know, he belongs to a particular area of research. For me, the research problem is more important. And what we want to deliver in the end, what we want to give it to the society. And it can be fundamental, it can be applied, it can be anywhere in between, doesn't matter. But choose the right problem and without worrying about very narrow research area can be explored further. Can we bring people with multiple expertise to achieve that? And that in my opinion is important. So with that, I end my talk here by acknowledging my groups. I have not talked about so much of my research activities, but I was more interested in giving an overview of an area which is emerging in India and which has a potential to address many societal problems. And when we talk about chemistry, the future direction of chemistry, chemistry of materials, chemistry of life processes, chemistry of environment, and this energy related, atmosphere, environment related, or human health related, and this is going to be the future of chemistry in my opinion. So I thank my students and collaborators, and thank the funding agencies. I thank you all for listening to this talk, and I would be happy to take any questions that you may have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mukesh. A wonderful exposition of what this nature is all about, and very intriguing sort of questions you asked, and fantastic answers you gave. So I think students would be very excited for sure. So Shastri, I think over to you.
Thank you. Now I don't want to be in between Mukesh and the students, and to coordinate the question answers, we have Monty and Lisa with us, and then they will be taking their question answers. Over to you, Monty and Lisa.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of our director and the entire SRTP team, we thank you, sir, for your insightful presentation. It was indeed a great pleasure for all of us to hear from you, sir. And we could not agree more on how nicely you have presented throughout. No wonder, sir, there are a lot of appreciation comments as well as a lot of questions in MS Team, Facebook and YouTube. So, sir, with your permission, we would like to proceed with the question and answer session. Should we, sir?
Yeah, sure. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So the first question is from Azim Khan. He is asking, what would have been the first enzyme to have formed when life began?
If you stop sharing your screen now, it will be good for the students. They can see you.
You want to stop, right?
Stop sharing the screen, then they can see the full view as of, yeah, that's good. Thank you.
Fine, okay. Yeah, it is, it's very difficult to answer, you know, what was the first enzyme? And, you know, we can say, you know, what was the first enzyme discovered or what was the first enzyme studied by certain techniques, because, you know, the tools required to identify, you know, what is that first one formed was not available. Okay, and many of the reports that are available can tell that when the tools became available to study, what was the first one discovered? Okay, it's difficult to tell what was the first enzyme. We can say, you know, what is the most active enzyme today? That's not possible to tell with 100% accuracy, because there may be something which has not been discovered.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, will artificial enzymes be able to recreate all the functions of the real enzyme?
It is, as I mentioned, artificial enzyme, the aim of developing artificial enzyme is to recreate certain key features of enzymes. Of course, you cannot create entirely a protein function, because if you create, I'm talking about the function of an enzyme rather than the structure of it, right? The structure of the protein may be different from what we create as artificial enzymes. But if we recreate a crucial function, I talked about a few examples, an enzyme which acts on hydrogen peroxide, recreating the function of controlling hydrogen peroxide level in human cells, because they are the one associated with the several diseases, can we achieve that function rather than achieving all the function of an enzyme? There are some of the functions which are not crucial, the enzymes. There may be a protein-protein interactions which are there in the cells. When there are hundreds of thousands of biomolecules in the cells, there is a protein-protein interaction which we may not be able to recreate with the enzymes, but the key function of the enzymes.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Shushamindra Kulkarni. She's asking, if the thyroid gland is removed, the person has to take artificial thyroxine throughout his life. Is there a way of thyroid transplant?
It has not been successful, and Kendall, who isolated thyroxine, you know, he was a surgeon who has done a lot of work on, you know, thyroid surgery. For example, people lose thyroid gland by cancer. Thyroid cancer is a specific type of cancer. And building this thyroid gland artificially, giving the thyroid follicular cells, arranging it in a proper way, why it is challenging, because I talked about, that's the reason I put the slides which thyroxine synthesis happens in the thyroid gland. It's a very, very special arrangements. You will not see such arrangements, you know, in other cells, right? Thyroid gland is like, you know, the follicular cells where the synthesis takes place. The assembly of the protein takes place, the synthesis of the basic protein takes place. But you see, the synthesis of thyroxine introducing iodine happens outside the follicular cells, which is called thyroid lumen. Okay, I can give you an example. We have, for example, you know, arranged cooking, right, in conferences. So we arrange food outside nicely. Cells are, you know, the nice arrangements is made, but the cooking happens backside. If you go and see the kitchen backside, and they make the food and bring it inside, right? This exactly similar things happen in thyroid gland. The synthesis happens backside of the cells. Okay, the protein should go outside the cells, then the chemical reaction takes place, and then they re-enter the cells and to get into the bloodstream. And making such an organ artificially is going to be very, very difficult. And the transplant also using a thyroid gland has not been successful. It is simple for the person to take synthetic thyroxine throughout the life. Okay, given the complications in the transplant. And that comes with the own drawbacks, because making or taking the right amount of synthetic thyroxine is also challenging. And that's the reason doctors suggest, if you are taking synthetic thyroxine, come and measure the TSH level, T4 level, you know, once in a while to see that the thyroid hormone level is maintained. And also, if someone, I am sure that many of you are taking, many of the people who are listening to this are taking thyroxine. And I would suggest that someone changes the brand, okay? People say, what is there in brand? We go to medical shops and ask for synthetic thyroxine. And the medical shop person says, you know, I do not have this particular one, not particular brand, but I have an equal brand, all are T4, right? Thyroxine, why don't you take that and go? But thyroxine is considered as therapeutically narrow index drug. Even small variation in the nature of thyroxine alters the thyroid functions. So as long as possible, one should stick to the same brand. If the brand is changed, they should do TSH T4 test again, consult the doctor again to monitor the optimum thyroid levels. And thyroid hormone is a master regulator of human metabolism. Change in the thyroid hormone affects the entire body metabolism and the function. So that's why one needs to be very careful.
Thank you, sir, for your such an elaborative, informative, and a useful answer. We are really overwhelmed to hear you, sir. So the next question is from Maitre Giri. Why spherical nanoenzymes showed highest activity compared to others, others as in nanoparticles with different crystal phases?
Yeah, this is, you know, when we consider the nanozymes, nanoparticles, the shape and morphology play important role. And initially people thought, you know, the nanozyme concept was introduced sometime in 2007. Only this area started developing after that. The first paper appeared in Nature about nanozyme, Fe-3O4 nanozymes. But when you look at, you know, the nanozyme activity in human cells or in mammalian cells, it not only depends on the surface property. People say when you have more surface area, it will be more activity. What we found is that's not true. The material which has less surface area can be more active because the type of surface, the reactivity of the surface plays an important role. And in some cases, the spherical particles may enter the cells much more than a rod. So it depends on the pathways by which they get into the cells and the amount of nanomaterials that they get into the cells. Another reason is the reactivity of the surface. If the spherical surface has a plane which is much more favorable for this type of reactions that we are trying to carry out, then that will be more active. But this is not the case always. Yeah, nano sheets or nano rods, wires can be more than a spherical particles. Depend on the type of reactions that we have.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Radhika Mankar. Sir, can nanotechnology play role in artificial enzyme preparation?
Yes, actually this is what I talked about, nanozymes, nanotechnology. And when we make, you know, protein synthetic molecules, what we do in organic reactions, right? We make molecules and we synthesize molecules in the lab several times to get reproducible when we make the same molecule with the same properties. And this is in nanotechnology, the synthesis is very challenging, and synthesizing same type of nanomaterials is really difficult. That is where, you know, optimizing the conditions to make nanomaterials which have similar property. What we have found in B205 nanozyme case, if you make 2-3 times the same nanomaterial, we think it is same nanomaterial. All the characterization data shows it is identical, but if you study the biological property, they are different and some of them are toxic. And that's where the precise nanotechnology method to make these nanozymes is important. And that is becoming nanomedicine, right? Nanomedicine is emerging as a major area now, and using nanoparticles, nanomaterials as drugs, right? And how do they enter the cells? Which organs they target and how they are eliminated? How stable they are? Are they toxic to the human? All these are important to look into, and that's why, you know, the emerging nanomedicine is becoming important to understand these properties.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Lavanya. PQQ is a novel cofactor with biological function. There are few microorganisms.
I could not hear you.
Sorry, sir. PQQ is a novel cofactor with many biological function. There are few microorganisms with PQQ, but E. coli, being the model organism also present in human intestine, does not have PQQ synthesizing gene. Incorporation of this gene can reduce immune response. If yes, how can it be done, sir?
Yeah, some of the genes which are present in bacteria and other species, which are, you know, they may have certain variations, improved functions, but finding those genes are difficult. But it is very difficult to tell that introducing such genes to human system is going to improve the immunity, because we know that, you know, biological system functions by feedback, and there are many coordinated pathways. And at this stage, you know, a particular gene introducing to human system, whether it's going to have a beneficial effects, it's difficult to tell. This PQQ system, I'm not aware of the positive effects that can have in human systems.
Thank you, sir. Can we ask you a few more questions if you have time?
Yeah, sure.
I see that there are a large number of questions. Ask two more questions.
Okay, sir.
Then we can give it. And Dr. Mugesh, our people have made a small slide, which sort of, are you able to see the slide?
Yeah, I saw.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Monty, go ahead.
Sir, the next question is from Sanskriti Pathak. She's saying that there are many different oxidant compounds that can harm the body, which may lead to oxidative stress and occurrence of diseases if not removed. What are the most oxidizing compounds that harm the body?
So the oxidizing agents, I talked about the reactive oxygen species. Hydroxyl radicals, some of them are, they perform reversible oxidations like hydrogen peroxide, right? It perform reversible oxidation. Hydroxyl radical has a very strong tendency to damage DNA, double strand break, because we know that DNA damage occurs all the time in human cells, but there are repair mechanisms, right? Nobel Prize was given for identifying such repair mechanisms. When these species break the double strand, it's more difficult to repair than the single strand break. Hydroxyl radical is one such species. And peroxynitrate is another potent oxidant which is produced in biological system. The reaction between superoxide and nitric oxide, we know nitric oxide is important. We know superoxide is important, but when these two combine to form peroxynitrite, which is very, very potent oxidizing agents and nitrating agents in biological systems. So these are the natural oxidants which are produced by physiological pathways, but when they are produced in uncontrolled way, very difficult to control them. That's where, one need to worry about artificial enzymes or upregulating enzymes which act on these oxidants. But also there are some oxidants which is produced by metal ions, reactions with the metal ions, but the key oxidant produced are hydroxyl radicals, peroxynitrite, and hydrogen peroxide, which is important, but it can be toxic when it goes to a higher amount, when it is produced in higher amount.
Thank you so much, sir. So the last question is from Abhishek Chhatar. Why hypoxic tumors grow up in the presence of oxygen transported by blood vessel? That is angiogenesis.
Sorry, I could not hear you.
Hypoxic tumors grow up in the presence of oxygen transported by blood vessels.
Yeah, the tumor level increases. You mean the tumor level increases under hypoxic condition? That's what your question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that is, related to the oxygen metabolism I talked about in the beginning of my talk, because the oxygen level not only depends on, oxygen metabolizing enzymes, but also, the enzymes which use oxygen transport, not only the oxygen transport, but also oxygen metabolizing enzymes. So they are affected under hypoxia condition. Okay, and cancer is a complicated disease. It is not a single disease, right? Cancer is a collective, diseases. And this is related to several, gene overexpression of gene and also the proteins. And this leads to a complicated biological pathways and increases the tumor growth. And it's very difficult to pinpoint a single pathway for such changes in the tumor size.
Thank you, sir, for so nicely answering all the queries.
Yeah.
I think it's wonderful to see that there are more questions than answers in this field. So it is definitely a good field to do research, because research is an area where you should be looking at more space which was not covered before, and the knowledge that one has will have some limitations, and I am sure that this particular lecture will trigger passion in people to work in mostly of the problem without worrying about to which category or to which particular fortuitously divided sub branch of science that you belong to. If Alok Dhawan has some comment he can make before I ask Swapnali to give vote of thanks.
No, I think it was a wonderful talk. I thoroughly enjoyed it, and of course the students, the excitement can be seen in the chat box. I think we're very fortunate to have Mukesh today give this wonderful talk. So yeah, back to you.
Back to Swapnali Hazarika.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. Honorable Director of CSIR NIST, Dr. G. Narahari Sastri, respected speaker, Professor G. Mukesh, Dr. Alok Dhawan, Director of IITR, and all the participants. It's my pleasure to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of the director and all the CSIR SRTP team members, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the honorable speaker for taking out your valuable time and gracing our program with your exemplary talk on the topic chemical biology of artificial enzymes. You have given an excellent coverage on it, sir, starting from periodic table to enzyme chemistry, and very interesting point on kitchen chemistry. Also, what should be the role of chemistry and chemist and biologist for interdisciplinary research work? Sir, you have given emphasis on fundamental research with a definite goals and deliverables. And most importantly, you have focused on future of chemistry. So we look forward to hear more from you, sir. I must mention a deep sense of appreciation to DGCSIR Professor Shekhar Simande for supporting us in every aspect, and Director CSIR NIST Dr. G. Narahari Sastri for organizing this summer research training program and giving this excellent platform for being virtually connected and spreading knowledge on this tough time. I also wish to express my gratitude to all the SRTP team members for providing their continuous support and working tirelessly towards making this program a successful one. I also thankful to Director IITR Dr. Alok Dhawan and Dr. V. Mutkavi, Head of 4PI, for their continuous support throughout this program. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the participants connected through MS Team, Facebook, YouTube Live for their active participation in today's session. Thank you everyone for being with us today. Take care and stay safe. Thank you. And this session ends here.
Thank you.
Thank you.